Has notice for this appeal been given?
It has.
Okay, Mr. Camerata.
Exhibit 1 is the notice. Exhibit 2 is the proof of publication. Exhibit 3 is the proof of posting of the notice. Exhibit 4 is the application and all of its attachments. And Exhibit 5 is the zoning ordinance as amended.
Okay, thank you. And would you like to give us your name and your address? And then our stenographer will swear you in.
My name is Rafael Ferreiras. It's E-R-R-E-I-R-A-S.
F-E-R-R-E-I?
R-A-S.
And Raphael, R-A?
R-A-F.
F-A-E-F.
Yeah.
Thanks.
All right, sir. There's two ways we can do this.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Oh,
I'm sorry. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you out? Sorry about that.
That's okay. All right, sir. There's two ways we can do this. You can either just present your case and we'll ask questions, or we can have our solicitor take you through a series of questions, and then if there's something else you would like to tell us, you know, you have the opportunity to do that.
Okay. I'm here representing Mr. Pedro
okay.
Rosario, because he can make it today.
Mr. Pedro Paulino?
Paulino, yes. I have his authorization right here. So,
okay.
But actually, I'm like delivering the message.
Okay.
That he intends to put a new business. It's going to be a family business. He lives by the same building. It was a top brand before.
He lives in the same building?
In the same building, yes.
Okay.
And with his family.
His family?
Yeah, with his family.
Oh, sorry.
And that building, it was vacant for a long time. He just bought the building like 4 years ago, I'm sorry. And he's been fixing the place. And right now, he want to have his business right there where he live.
Okay.
And all the information that they asked me for, we put it over there so you can take a look at it. And that's going to be, we have a parking space in the back. We have a 21 by 21, two parking space. And actually, it's going to be, almost the same kind of business. I think it was still burned before.
I think it was.
But it was closed for a long time.
It was what before?
It was vacant for a long time.
Vacant for a long time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
did you say it was burnt before it burned?
No.
No.
Vacant.
Okay, I thought
it was a bar. It was some time ago.
It was a bar.
Yeah, it was a bar.
Before we proceed, can we just mark the affidavit
sure.
as Exhibit 6?
And it says
I'm
here.
I'm sorry, wait a second.
Oh, I'm sorry, I apologize.
Okay.
Okay. A clarification here. Maybe you can answer this, or maybe our zoning officer can. It says to operate a convenience store, or in the alternative, a special exception to convert a tavern into a convenience store. And I'm a little confused as to why it's worded that way.
Correct. The applicant is requesting to operate the convenience store on the first floor and to live above it as their single family dwelling on the upper floors. The district is the R3 district. Convenience stores are not permitted uses within the R3.
Okay.
The question comes, was the previous non-conforming use, tavern, was it abandoned? My position is that yes, in fact, it was abandoned. Therefore, this is a variance request. However, they allow the applicant to submit this also as a special exception for your consideration, so that you can consider going from one non-conforming use to another non-conforming use that may be deemed to be of equal or less intensity on the character of the neighborhood.
Okay.
Gotcha.
All
right. Gentlemen, anybody here have any questions of this man?
Do you know what his intended hours of operation are?
We write all the information about, I think it's from 8 to 10.
7 days a week.
Yeah, 7 days.
8, 10, 7 days.
Normally, grocery store is open 7 days a week.
Okay.
In the city.
You mentioned that there are two parking places on
in the
side.
Back, yeah.
Does the owner plan to use one of those for himself?
Well, those could be used for the storage. Yeah, because there is a lot of space on the street that actually he's not using it right now.
I see it's capable of being fenced off, I think, if I look at the picture.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
If I can add a few clarifications, the application for days and hours of operation Monday through Sunday, 7 a.m. to 10 p.m.
7.
And the two parking spaces in the rear of the property are enclosed with a fence, mm-hmm. and the fence in front, where you'd have to open it, mm-hmm. is a sliding fence.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And does the applicant intend to install any type of signage?
Yes. And you have the picture over there. It's going to be an awning.
It's going to be an awning?
Yes.
Is this the?
No.
Is that going to be one of those that's lit up? It won't be lit up and flashing or anything.
Well, there is another kind of light right now, which is LED. If you let us do it, I think he would like to have it. If there is any problem, or you think that it's better if he don't have, I mean, he can use that. That's depend on you. If you let us do it, we go ahead and do it.
And we can regulate that type of thing. So. All right. Any questions from anybody here on the board?
So I see in the pictures there's like a grill and fryers and stuff like that, but they're not planning on using that stuff?
He is planning to offer prepared foods for takeout.
Okay.
Or let me rephrase that. He is requesting that you approve him to prepare foods for takeout.
Okay.
Because it is a big place. It's a big place. So you want to use the whole space.
And would the applicant agree to any conditions the board would place on if they were to approve the variance?
I think yes. Depends. He wants to have his business. He live up there. If he have his kids over there, there is a way. I mean, it's very good. So he have to go upstairs and take a rest, and then all the member of the family take care of the business. And but that's depend on you. If you let us have the business as he's asking, or if you want to change anything.
All right, anybody else have any questions here from either the board or you gentlemen? No? All right, anybody in the audience have any questions of this gentleman? Anybody want to testify for granting the application? Anybody want to testify against? Okay, seeing none, that concludes this appeal, and we'll issue the decision at next month's meeting. Either he nor you have to be here. It will be mailed to you. Okay? Thank you,
sir.
Okay. You still okay, Holly?
Yes, thank you.
Next matter before us is 928 North 13th Street. It's appeal 2015-26. Okay. While they're coming up, you guys can be seated there. While they're coming up, do you want to swear in our zoning officer?
I do.
Has this notice of this appeal been given?
It has.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Camerano.
Good
Exhibit 1 is the notice. Exhibit 2 is the proof of publication. Exhibit 3 is the proof of posting of the notice. Exhibit 4 is the application and all of its attachments. And Exhibit 5 is the zoning ordinance as amended.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Are all of you gentlemen going to testify this evening?
I am.
You are? And?
Yeah.
Okay. All three of
all
you.
All three of
you. All right. You want to give the stenographer your names and then she'll swear you in.
Ronald Jackson, Accomplished Remodeling.
Accomplished?
Accomplished Remodeling. Yeah.
Do you need an address?
Give your address, please.
Yeah, sure. Not better for you. 1336 Kenny Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19602.
Can you spell Kenny for me? I'm sorry.
K-E-N-N-Y.
Okay. And your name, sir? Parminder.
Yes.
And then F-I-N-G-H?
Yes.
R-E-S-H-I-W-A-L-I-A?
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And your name, sir?
Vijay Agnihotri.
Can you spell it?
V like Victor, I-J-A-Y.
Yes. No, no.
A little bit slower. Go ahead.
Maybe Victor. He wants to write it for me.
Yeah.
Let me know.
Give me known people.
Thank you.
Okay, we can do this one of two ways, as I told people before. If you want to,
I'll do it again.
Oh,
would you all raise your right hands? Raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help God?
Yes, I do.
Okay,
sorry.
Okay.
You want
to,
thank
I
you.
Have to do
the spelling. That's all right.
Okay.
Get it done once.
Excuse me. Leave me alone. Harass you.
We can do this one of two ways. You can present your case on your own, or we can have our solicitor take you through a series of questions. We might have some additional questions, and you folks can add anything that you would like to.
Question away.
All right. Okay. Mr. Jackson, will you be speaking on behalf of?
Yes.
Okay. I guess the first question is, who currently owns the subject property?
Yeah.
Okay. You'll have to verbalize it so that it's on the
record. Oh, okay. The owner's sitting next to me.
Yeah.
Okay. And what's currently at the subject property?
It's a three-bay garage, gas pumps outside. We'd like to convert it into a convenience store.
Okay.
Which is all going to be done by subcontractors. I'm the general contractor. I'm hiring all the contractors to do all the work.
Okay.
So.
And could you describe the building in terms of square footage?
I believe it's a little less than 2,000 square feet.
Okay.
Ceiling height is 13 feet. It's got three bays. It's got a small snack bar in the front of the store.
And what are the proposed changes to the?
We want to expand the snack bar into the store itself, get rid of the bay garages, frame it all in, lower the ceiling, new electric, new heater system, new floors, new ceilings, everything we've totally redone.
Okay. And could you also describe the surrounding neighborhood?
It's right off of 13th Street or right on 13th Street. There's plenty of parking. As far as it being a lot of square feet, it is. I don't know the total square feet of the building or the property itself. But you guys have a layout of the total square feet.
Right down from Reading High.
You're right across the street from Reading High.
Half acre?
Yeah.
And what's the parking like around the area?
Well, we have a site plan that's laid out for eight parking areas. that include the handicap zone. There is space available for a lot more parking if need be. We need more parking for it.
Are the gas pumps still there?
Yes, still gas pumping.
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't hear any of that.
What was your question, Mr. Hart?
The question I was going to say is the gas pump's still there.
Yeah, we sell gas right now. We sell right now very low price in the city, $2.39.
Okay. And in
the future, we want to sell our low price inside in the grocery store. At least we don't want to make too much, just a little bit.
Okay. Do you know when the last time the gas pumps, the gas tanks underground were replaced? That's such a big deal today. Yeah. Have they been replaced recently?
No, that's already fiberglass tank.
I'm sorry, that's already what?
A fiberglass tank and fiber lines, everything.
So it's all been approved.
And we have it.
Wait.
Now, can't have three people talking at once, one at a time.
Yeah, we have next week is the new pumps to come in, Gilbarco S700, like it cost $73,000.
$73,000
pumps coming. We have old pumps right now, but we have put in the new pumps. I see the customers, the old pump like handle up and down, we don't like it. Is the new lock coming, EMB, like chip reader, something like that.
EMB.
EMB compliant, something like that. A car reader, like chip readers.
Yeah.
Is the new lock coming in October. This October.
Coming in October?
Yeah, to 2017. Every gas station have a change to the car reader, like a chip system.
Right.
Then we have already did order. We have come in new pumps. Yeah, we sell already gas over there right now.
So the change is really, you only want to change this store into the more convenient store, but the gas will remain.
Right.
Wait.
You guys can't all talk at once. One of you at a time.
We have already store, this small store. We have a couple, three fridges, and we want a little bigger cooler to the neighborhood needing milk and more stuff.
Okay. Yeah. I think I got it now.
Yeah.
One question I have is, how are you going to be able to control student traffic when school's in session? And the reason that I ask that question is a number of businesses that are along there sometimes have had a lot of problems with students congregating there. There have been a lot of issues. And so that is something that you're going to need to think about. And I guess which leads to my next statement, are you going to have any kind of a video security system on your property?
Yes.
Okay.
Inside and out.
And outside.
Yes.
Okay. What will the hours of operation be?
From 5 a.m. to 11.
And how many employees will there be?
2 full-time, 4 part-time.
And will you have any additional signage on the property?
No, we have already one sign for gas, that's it.
The proposal was 2 new signs put on the building itself, which would be called Food Mart in the front, and one on the side of the building. Also we call Food Mart.
Oh, so this is not the sign that's there now?
Yes, it is. That sign's not there now. That's the proposal for the new sign.
Okay.
There's one concern I have with if this is approved and you have the increased business because it's going to be now a convenience store. Very familiar with that because I'm in the area. And one of the things I'm most concerned about, and I don't know if we'll come up with the traffic, but coming up Spring Street, it's very easy to turn into that property, at the Spring Street entrance coming up.
Mm-hmm.
But boy, when somebody's waiting at that light and it's a very busy intersection, people get, when they try and come out at that Spring Street to turn left to go down, it's really bad. I can see. I don't know if something could be arranged for that with the traffic flow, maybe turn in, okay, but to turn, to exit, to turn left, no, or even turn right.
Can we make it to where there's no right-hand turn onto that street? Would that help?
It doesn't matter, right turn or left. When people come, they're waiting, I can see people, you know, butting heads there. It is really bad. That's just a suggestion.
Yeah, and that's something that we could put in our recommendations, that a traffic study be done and see if the traffic department has recommendations.
Just that one, just that cut.
That's a good idea.
And would the applicant agree to whatever conditions the board would place on granting the variance?
Yes, we'll adapt.
Okay. You have a question?
No.
No? Okay. Anybody have any questions here?
Just one question.
Go ahead.
What are the current days and hours of operation for this store?
5 a.m. to 11 p.m.
Monday through Sunday?
Monday through Sunday.
So when you change it, assuming the board approves this to a convenience store, the hours and days of operation will not change?
Will not change.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, anybody in the audience have any questions of these gentlemen? All right, seeing none. Anybody want to testify for granting the application? Anybody want to testify against granting the application? Seeing none, that concludes this appeal. Decision will be issued to you next month, and you need not be here. It will be mailed to you. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Good location.
Yes.
See ya.
Yes.
All right. Okay, the next matter before us is 850 Laurel Street. It's appeal 2015-27. You want to swear in our zoning officer?
As your right hand, please. Be sure to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you
out. I do.
Okay, Mr. Cameraner.
Exhibit 1 is the notice. Exhibit 2 is the proof of publication. Exhibit 3 is the proof of posting of the notice. Exhibit 4 is the application and all of its attachments. And Exhibit 5 is the zoning ordinance as amended.
Mr. Pfeiffer, quick question. Has notice for this appeal been given?
It has.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Orlando, we'll let you enter your appearance, and then we'll swear in anybody you're going to have testify.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Good evening. Eugene Orlando, Jr., here on behalf of Evergreen Community Power and the related companies. And all three gentlemen will testify, Art McLaughlin, Ryan Kennedy, and Derek Tsai.
Okay, I didn't get those names. I didn't hear your first name.
It's Art McLaughlin.
Art. M.C.?
Capital L.
Oh, it's you. I was going this way. You didn't start with the guy in the end. Sorry. Sure. You could be indicated as Mr. McLaughlin all night if I didn't hear that. M.C.?
Capital L-A-U-G-H-L-I-N.
Okay.
Ryan Kennedy.
Okay.
Derek Tsai. T-S-A-I.
I?
I, yes.
And Derek?
Derek, D-E-R-E-K.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Orlando?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Application before you tonight is for a special exception. This is going to be our end product if the board grants our special exception. Mr. Tsai is going to describe the process to you. Mr. Kennedy is going to go through our zoning criteria. Mr. McLaughlin is going to give you an overview. And we start with the board, please, with Mr. McLaughlin.
And I didn't swear them in again. Raise your right hands, please. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help God?
I do, too.
Okay. I would actually like the person that's doing the most of the testifying.
Yeah. With Ryan.
I need to be able to hear.
And when you speak, you have to keep your voice up and point it in her direction.
Okay. I think we're going to be musical chairs. When it's his turn, he'll move up. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Mr. McLaughlin, what's your position with this application?
I'm the general manager for United CoreStack.
And what relationship does United CoreStack have with Evergreen Community Power?
United CoreStack and Evergreen are affiliated companies under the same parent.
And is Phoenix Systems also an affiliated company?
They are.
And the application, I believe before you, we have the exhibits, applicant exhibit number one. Is that authorization from the owner of the property for you to be here on behalf of the company?
It is.
And who is the owner?
The owner is Evergreen Community Power.
Oh.
The overall parent is Indevco.
I didn't hear the name.
Indevco, I-N-D-E-V-C-O.
Thank you.
And what is Cedar Pack?
Cedar Pack is another affiliated company under the parent Indevco.
And they actually have title to this property, do they not?
They do.
Could you spell that one?
Cedar Pack?
Yeah.
C-E-D-A-R-P-A-K.
Is it all one word?
It is.
Thanks.
And I believe the deed is attached to the application, gentlemen. Mr. McLaughlin, look at exhibit number two, applicant exhibit number two.
Mr. Orlando, do you mind if I interrupt you? Would you like to mark the binder as exhibit six?
That's fine, however you wish to mark it on your record. I have the applicant exhibits numbered 1 through 14 in the book.
Okay. Do you mind if we just mark the binder that you're looking at as exhibit six?
I do it.
Sorry. Now, there's an exhibit six in the book, itself, so you want
right,
to...
Right, we can...
I'll refer to our exhibits as applicant exhibits.
Okay.
I think to clarify for the record...
I'm sorry, I'm not on the record yet. Sorry.
If you don't mind referring to them maybe as exhibit 6-whatever.
However you tell me you want them referred to, that's what you get.
Just so it's clear for the record, collectively, the binder is exhibit 6, and then the subparts will just be dash and then the number.
Mr. McLaughlin, looking at exhibit 6-1.
Six.
That's your authorization to be here? 6-1.
Yes, it is.
Okay, with regard to applicant 6-2, tell us what that shows in the bottom left-hand corner.
The bottom left-hand corner shows the view of the property from Laurel Street.
And that's the building that we're here to talk about tonight, correct?
It is.
What's that building being used for prior to this application?
Prior to this application, we utilized this building for storage of paper, warehousing.
So it was used for warehousing for UCI?
It was.
And if the board grants our special exception, it'll be used for this new compounding operation. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right, now let me ask you to look at exhibit 6-3 so that we can orient the board to the related facilities that surround the building. Tell us what 6-3 is, Mr. McLaughlin.
6-3 is an overview photograph of South Reading, including the affiliated properties.
All right, what's the big black line that goes up on the right and then sort of forks out?
The large black line indicates the industrial collector that we use for traffic in and out of the business area.
Is that where all the trucks come in and out for all of these facilities?
Yes.
They come in and out for UCI?
They do.
Evergreen Community Power?
They do.
And if there are trucks for this operation, they will also follow that same route?
They would follow that same route.
Now, the area that's marked in kind of a yellowish green, is that also locate 850 Laurel, which is what we're talking about?
Yes.
There are no trucks on Laurel, though, is that correct?
There are no trucks on Laurel Street.
And there will not be any trucks on Laurel Street, is that also correct?
That is correct.
All right, if you would look then at... but before we leave exhibit 6-3, because some of the board members were here when we were back here in 2008 to get the variance for Evergreen Community Power, but some of the board members may not have been here. So the area that's marked on exhibit 6-3 as ECP, is that the power plant?
It is.
Now, part of what we want to do involves product from that power plant, does it not?
That's correct.
Can you quickly describe that? I know Dr. Tsai is going to give us more details, but generally give us a description.
At United Core Stack, we manufacture paper that goes into corrugated boxes. Evergreen Community Power provides us with the steam electricity for the manufacturing process. And as a byproduct from the power plant, ash that currently goes to landfill will be utilized as a beneficial use in a product that we'll present to you.
All right, now let's look at 6-4. Take a look at parking and parking needs for the entire facility that involves both UCI, Phoenix, ECP, and the new proposed use.
Yes.
And as a result of your looking at that, did you compile a document which we've marked as Exhibit 6-4?
I have.
All right, walk us through that document so that we know what the total parking spaces that are available and the total that would be needed.
The total parking spaces, looking at all locations based on where we have people positioned throughout the facility, would be 253 spaces.
And that's shown at the top of the first page there?
It is.
Now, let's go through each of the operations, UCI, ECB, Phoenix, and the proposed Evergreen compounding.
During the peak loading, which would be Monday through Friday during the day work, we would have up to 45 people at United Course Tech. At ECP, or Evergreen Community Power, we would have 22. Phoenix Technology Holdings, we would have 5. And Evergreen Compounding, which is a proposed operation, would have 6.
All right, now we're going to actually have more employees than that, but this is 6 during shift.
At the same time.
So, if I did my math correctly, that's 78 spaces that would be needed, is that correct?
Correct.
And we have available to us how many?
253.
All right, now part of what you have listed here also involves some spaces, even though we're way over, but just to be clear, you have Nativity BVM parking listed as available parking. Do we have a written agreement with the church for our parking?
We do.
All right, now with regard to truck traffic, you've already said based on Exhibit 6-3 that it comes in and out the collector, and that's where all the trucks will go. Is there going to be additional truck traffic for the Evergreen compounding project?
There will be some.
Do you know what it will be?
For Evergreen compounding, it would be an additional 2 trucks per week. Monday through Friday inbound, and Monday through Friday outbound would be 9 trucks.
But there's also going to be then some reduction for trucks going out for Evergreen Community Power. Is that also correct?
That's correct.
Can you explain that?
There would no longer be ash trucks leaving the site that currently leave.
And that's because the ash is part of the product that's going to be going into our compounding?
That's correct.
Take a look at Exhibit 6-5. Tell us what that is.
That's a shot, that's a photograph of the building from the west.
It shows some of the additional parking available?
It does show some of the open area that was available for parking.
All right, and if you would, in Exhibit 6-6, the ordinance requires that we provide a plot plan that shows the boundaries. Can you identify this as that plot plan?
This is that plot plan.
All right, we're going to give you a break unless the board has questions for Mr. McLaughlin, and then we'll have Mr. Kennedy to walk us through some of the other exhibits and the facilities and compliance with the ordinance.
Any questions, gentlemen?
All right, Mr. McLaughlin, take seat number 2 here. Mr. Kennedy, go up there next to our stenographer.
Thank you.
All right, state your name and your employer, Mr. Kennedy.
My name is Ryan Kennedy. I'm employed at NTEC Engineering in Reading.
Are you a licensed architect in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania?
Yes.
Take a look at Exhibit 6-7. Does that accurately summarize your expertise and experience in licensing?
It is.
Consists of 2 pages?
Yes, both pages.
Okay, gentlemen, I'm going to have Mr. Kennedy express opinion, so I'm offering him as an expert. I don't know if anyone wants to question his qualifications.
I think we would stipulate that he's
Thank you very much. All right, Mr. Kennedy, take a look at Exhibit 6-8. Tell us what 6-8 is.
This is a drawing depicting two elevations of the existing building with the proposed roof modifications.
All right, so there are some roof modifications, but with regard to this project, is the footprint of this building changing at all?
No.
So tell us, walk us through, if you would please, from an outside appearance, what, if anything, is going to be different? So there's no footprint change, so there's no addition or anything, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, walk us through what facilities there are.
There will be, on the interior, there will be compounding equipment, which will require the roof to be raised 14 feet. There will be two self-contained rooms built inside the 24-foot-high warehouse space, which is currently a warehouse. On the outside, on the east side of the building, there will be a retaining wall built, which will provide a level grade for equipment that will be ancillary to the compound equipment on the inside.
Now, the roof's being raised, you said 14 feet.
Correct.
Is that still within the height limitation for the MC district?
Yes, it is.
So we comply with height? Do we comply with other requirements in the MC district with regard to this use?
Yes, we do.
All right, you said there will be a retaining wall. Can you show us that? Perhaps it's on Exhibit 6-9.
Can you point it up there?
Oh, yeah, sure. Mr. Kennedy has a larger map that may be easier to see than the little copy in the book.
Okay, so this is Laurel Street. This is north. This is the 24-foot high section of the building right here. This is the rear of the building. This is the parking lot we were just talking about. This is the retaining wall right here. This is a railroad.
So the property butts right up against the railroad right away, doesn't it?
Correct, yes.
And where is the retaining wall being constructed?
Along the east side of the wall, our building.
You said that was for equipment. What's going to go between the retaining wall then and the building as part of this project?
A transformer, two cooling towers, an ash silo, and an ash blower.
All right, now you say cooling towers. How big are those towers?
They are 17 feet, 6 inches high.
Say that again, please.
17 feet, 6 inches high, off grade.
So are they lower than the portion of the building that we're raising?
Yes.
Would they be looking at your, if you go back to Exhibit 6-2, which are the series of photos that you had, looking at the bottom left-hand photo, will you be able to see those cooling towers if you were standing on Laurel Street, the same place you took that picture?
No, you will not.
All right, now you also said a silo. Will you be able to see the silo?
Yes, you will.
All right, but how high is the silo?
40 feet.
Is that within the height limitation within the MC zone?
Yes, it is.
And what's that silo? Is it going to contain?
I would
that's a question for the doctor.
There'll be a fly ash.
Alright, so Ryan, have a seat again.
Could I ask a question? I go by that property every day on the way to work and back. There's something laying in front of those buildings right now that is not in that picture. Big white, they look like towers. But as I say, I go by there every day, and there's two great big circular items laying in that parking lot right now. I have no idea if that's part
there,
of this.
There will be the silos. One will be the silo going to sit on the outside. The other one will be the finished goods silo will be inside, put in inside the building.
Okay, so
if you take a look at Exhibit 6-5, I think you might be able to see what you're referring to.
That's it.
Okay. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, now, except for the area that you've just been describing, well, first of all, did you finish describing the area in the back there with the retaining wall? And
yes.
Except for that area, there's no, otherwise no exterior change to the building at all, is that correct?
That's correct.
Now, the construction of the retaining wall and the platform for the transformer and the towers, that's, I think, actually already been permitted by the city, is that correct?
That is correct.
Would you take a look at Exhibit 6-10A through 6-10D and walk us through those?
10A is a zoning permit for the scope of work at the retaining wall, the excavation of the earth, and the equipment pads.
Now what's 10B? 6-10B.
It's a permit issued by the City of Reading Building and Trades Division for the excavation and installation of the retaining structure.
All right, how about 6-10C?
Also a permit by City of Reading's Building and Trades Division for the concrete the pads for the cooling tower, silo foundation, exterior foundation, everything on the exterior equipment-wise.
And then these have all been approved, is that correct?
Correct.
All right, and then D is what?
There's a letter from the Berks County Conservation District.
So they've approved this as well?
They have, yes.
All right, as you understand it, to the extent that there is any equipment, will that equipment be sited and located in accordance with the setback requirements of the ordinance?
All the equipment is will be outside the setbacks, meaning they're compliant.
And does the proposal and the plans that are shown in the exhibits, they demonstrate compliance with all other objective criteria of the zoning ordinance that's applicable here in your opinion?
Yes, they do.
To the extent that there is any aspect of the proposed project that will that we haven't thought to cover, is the company prepared to comply with any other requirements that may come up during any permitting or review with Mr. Piper?
Yes, the company right now is selecting the exterior equipment. They do have the noise classifications for them, and they're willing to do whatever is necessary to make sure it complies with the zoning ordinance.
All right, I think we're ready for bachelor number three. Okay. Unless the board has questions.
Anybody have any questions at this point? No? All right.
Mr. Kennedy, come down here. Hi, Derek, tell us your name and your address, please.
My name is Derek Tsai. I will be the plant manager for this compounding operation.
All right, let's take a look at Exhibit 6-11. In the book there, is that a summary of your experience?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, do I have to refer to you as Dr. Sai?
Yes, you could.
Okay, doctor. Now, tell us, give us a description, if you would, about what this operation is and how it works.
Well, the operation will be basically take a conventional plastic in the pellet shape, looks like the sample we provide.
In the pellet shape?
Pellet, yes. In a pellet shape, like little piece. They'll be going through a mix with the byproduct from power plant, which is a fly ash, and going through the heat cycle to melt the plastic, and then mix with the fly ash, and then push into a cooling system, and then cool down into the pellet shape again.
All right, now, you mentioned fly ash. What other materials? Is there anything dangerous here to human beings?
No, basically we try to disperse the fly ash and mix with the plastic, so we have put dispersant to help distribute. Dispersant. Dispersant. Yes, sorry about it.
Okay.
And they'll help to disperse the fly ash into the plastic. And that is not any human harmful material to
do with this?
Operators and even into the public.
All right, so all of the materials that are going into this process, are any of them at all volatile, harmful to humans?
No, they are not.
And so if you would take a look at, or before you look at that, this process, describe, you know, what goes in and how it comes out.
Well, basically we will have a transferring system to move the plastic put into a machine called extruder. And the extruder will be heating up we can control temperature and heat up and melt the plastic, and then we size stuff, basically the size inject the fly ash.
Size stuff. Okay.
And then into the machine, when into the molten plastic, and then machine will help to disperse the fly ash, and then go into a one underwater pelletizing system to cut those things into the pellet.
All right, if you would take a look at Exhibit 6-12, tell us what that photograph shows.
That is the equipment we are going to use there for, as I mentioned earlier, the extruder.
That's the extruder machine?
Yes, that's
okay.
Correct.
And so the stuff, the material is mixed together and is forced through this machine and heated?
Yes.
And then it comes out and is very cooled and then cut?
Yes, correct.
And when we're all done, is this what we get?
Yes.
And then what do people do with this?
Well, people do that with, it would be do the injection molding into the consumer goods, like a coat hanger or plastic covers for cell phone, computers, even helmet or trays.
So this material is actually then sold to other manufacturers who make something with it?
Correct.
And this was a byproduct of the process?
This is the byproduct.
This was a byproduct?
Yes.
Part of that,
yes.
Under normal circumstances, years ago, maybe thrown away.
Correct.
Right?
But yes.
This is going to, okay.
Now, take a look, if you would please, in Exhibit 6-13. Tell us what they are.
Those will be the equipment to help transfer the raw material, the plastic material, into the extruder.
This is all equipment that will be inside the building, is that correct?
Correct, yes.
And the process you described is all inside, is it not?
Inside the building, yes.
Okay. Then what is Exhibit 6-14?
This is the inside the building will be taking care, I think, this is the building, the location we're going to use, put an extruder. This is the Eagle building, I believe.
This is inside the building?
Yes.
Yeah. And over there in the corner is where you're going to put the extruder?
Yeah, you will see there's the three columns from left and right. There'll be the first two columns, the extruder will be in between the columns.
Okay. Now you're starting with one machine, right?
Correct.
But we're designing this for a second one.
We are designing for the future expansion for the second machine.
And if you would please turn back to the Exhibit 6-9, which is the plan that Mr. Kennedy authenticated for us.
Yes.
That shows the area where the two extruders will eventually be if this thing is successful and works out.
Yes, that's correct.
And then just flip back to Exhibit 6-14. That's a picture of the empty space where those things will eventually go, right?
That's correct, yes.
Okay. Dr. Tsai, other than the silo that you mentioned, which will collect or be part of the material storage.
That's right.
That Ryan said will be outside. Would anybody know what's going on from outside the building in terms of this operation?
No, all the material transfer system would be a closed loop, so everything would be closed to prevent the dust coming out or anything's coming out from the, to have people to see the material coming out.
Okay, so there will be no heat, dust, or smoke that emanates from the building?
No.
Anything that would be harmful to the neighborhood?
No, there will be none.
I don't have anything further, Dr. Tsai, unless anybody has any questions.
Is this unique to, is this a patented operation, or is this unique in the industry? Who else does this kind of stuff?
Well, right now, so far, there's no industry working the same. This is a proprietary process, and then we are working the process to patent those kind of applications.
Okay.
All right. Anybody here have any other questions?
Right. I'd like none. To move the exhibit of my exhibit number 6.
Yeah.
Okay. 6 and following.
All right.
Before we close, I'd just like to say something. Many years ago, CoreStax came to us to put their trash to steam plant, and as Mr. Orlando might remember, we got a lot of heat from a lot of people about doing that, and it has turned out to be very successful. It's been a good addition to our city. One of the few groups that came before us that didn't ask for any kind of tax breaks or anything else and fulfilled their obligations, as submitted. And I think that speaks well for the company. So I wanted to put that on the record. Okay. Seeing nothing else and nobody in the audience to testify. Oh, I'm sorry.
No. I'll keep my questions brief. First question for both Mr. McLaughlin and Dr. Tsai. As you were not part of the initial zoning process intake, we had extensively met with your design team, at which time I had explained to them that in a gesture of good faith, we would issue zoning permits so that you could start the work right away in terms of preparing for this ultimate process or the end result of this process. And that they understood that this did not necessarily grant any type of approval for the manufacturing of the plastics or polymers in this location. Was that conveyed to you?
Yes, it was.
Okay. So you understand that the actual process of what you're requesting tonight is dependent upon the zoning hearing board's granting of approval?
We did.
Okay. Thank you. My second question, the city of Reading has received concerns from adjacent neighbors. And those concerns have been over noise and vibration from the existing tower. Don't quote me on specifically the tower, but whatever causes noise and vibrations at the plant currently. Would you be amenable, as a condition of approval, to studying that a little bit further, providing maybe pre- and post-test results, and finding ways to maybe perhaps further mitigate whatever sound and vibration is coming from that tower?
Yes.
Thank you.
Anything else? All right, that concludes this application. We'll make our decision at next month's meeting, and you need not be here. The decision will be mailed to you, and we thank you, gentlemen, for an excellent presentation.
Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
And I want to thank Mr. Preston for his cooperation. He's been great to work with. And Mr. Zablick, who was in touch with you, was not able to be here. He doesn't want me to pass that along. So thank you.
Thank you.
We also appreciate our zoning officer, as well as our
yes,
solicitor.
Yes, we do.
So, okay, gentlemen, we're not done yet. We have to issue a decision.
Unless you want to keep those plastic things.
Oh, okay.
You're welcome occasionally.
Rabbit food.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good luck. Okay, good night. All right, we have one decision to be rendered. It's 701 Penn Street. It was appeal 2015-23.
Is there a motion to approve the requested relief subject to the conditions as set forth in the written decision?
So moved.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Seeing nobody?
All right, thank you, everybody. That closes our hearing for this month. We will see you the second week in September, the second Wednesday in September, and hope all of you have a good rest of the summer.